I do whatever, it's all good.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. And for braving this tiny class. It has been prompted by this sefer which I had the schus to write, well, translate and explain. And, one second, let's just see if I've got this working. So what is this all about? What does the Tanya do for us? Where did it come from? What value is it to us? Is it a particular path? Is it a general path? I'm going to spend 5 or 10 minutes just giving him a brief introduction along addressing those points. Where did it come from? So it's written by Rabbi Shmuel Zalman of Liadi, who was lived in the 18th century. And he was the third generation of the Hasidic movement, starting with Baal Shem Tov. Baal Shem Tov had not that many disciples, a handful of 20, 30, 40 disciples who he taught Torah to that we know of. And the most prominent of his disciples was the Maggid of Mizritch. And the Maggid of Mizritch was really the first one to teach the Hasidic path to students who went and became influential in their own communities. He had about 60 students that we know of, and both the Maggid and the Baal Shem Tov lived in the south of Poland, which was not a place where many, wasn't a large population, and it wasn't a very, it wasn't an establishment type community. The main community was in Vilna, in Vitebsk, several hundred miles away. So, what we see very interestingly in this period, Rabbi Shmuel Zalman's period, beginning with the Maggid, is what began as a group of mystics studying whatever they were studying, Zohar, Kabbalah, and trying to forge a new way in Avodas Hashem to strengthen Kavanas HaMitzvahs, Ava, Yira, strengthen our connection to the Ribbono Shel Olam. But this was happening in a very very off the map type of place. It was not under rabbinic control. The south of Poland was actually lost to Turkey for 20 years, and then the Polish got it back. So it was really a very it was a place where you could do weird stuff and get away with it. So the fact that the Baal Shem Tov was doing his work in that area really didn't affect very much the Jewish world. He had his students, but it wasn't so influential. The Maggid also, it's only when the students of the Maggid, who came from, many of them were Rabbonim in communities, or they became Rabbonim in major communities, they went out, we began this process of taking this new path, these new ideas, which, as you're going to see, nothing's really new. It's all based on something that came before, but just the precise formulation, the way it was being implemented, the flavor of it. And Rabbi Shmuel Zalman of Liadi was the first of this era who bridged that gap, going from my contemporary illustration was like going from Boulder to Borough Park. Baal Shem Tov lived in the middle of nowhere. And Rabbi Shmuel Zalman Liadi is taking this stuff and teaching it to very established communities full of people who were learning and davening, serious Jews. I mean, of course, you know, in this period it wasn't unusual for someone to be Bar Kippah Shas, a completely different level of Yerushalayim and Yediyah in Torah to what we have nowadays, generally. But nevertheless, he synthesized, really, what he'd learned from his teacher and his teacher's teacher, and he made it, some say he kind of fused the Litvish path with the Hasidic path, but more precisely what he did is he made it rabbinic. He showed where these things are written in Shas. He found sources for everything, and he made it a very substantial source book of how to worship Kodesh Baruch. Now, since then, it became very successful. Tanya was one of the most printed books, or the most successful, just in terms of sales of copies, in terms of kind of worship manuals, which came out in this period. And to this day, it's remained as a very significant guide to Hasidic worship, which is, of course, based on their Arizal, which is, of course, based on the Zohar. So that's the chain of where it's coming from. And it's unique, really. Most of the Hasidic Torahs were never written by the Rebbes themselves. They were written by students. And even when they were written down, they were not written down systematically as a kind of guidebook. Well, just a vart here, a vart there. So you didn't really get a picture of, you know, how do I do this? It didn't really guide you in implementation. And so Tanya came along and it kind of filled that void. It is quite practical. Not systematic is the right word, but it has a structure to it. I don't know if any of you have my book here.
Yeah.
Marty has it. So we didn't include this in the sheet. The sheets were made very kindly at the last minute. But in the beginning here, I kind of put a map of the structure of the book. And what we're going to attack in the beginning, what I call the basics here, is he really just lays down the basic knowledge and structure that you need to understand the rest of the book. So it's really quite kind of a crash course in the structure of the universe and the structure of the soul based on Zohar, Kabbalah, Arizal, as it's filtered through the Baal Shem Tov. Now, I don't want to harp on too long about this, because I want to actually study it. So, any questions on that? That's a very abridged version of my 3-hour lecture on this topic.
Do you have any of those books available today?
An author always travels with his books. Yes, yes, I do.
You're autographing them.
Yes. If you want to use it for the class and purchase it afterward, they're in that bag. Meanwhile, you can take the sheet. There's a sheet here. Do you have the sheet? Oh, you have a Tanya. Oh, you still need the sheet. Now, important question. Is the Tanya a Chabad book? Is it meant for Chabad people? So, the Tanya, when the Tanya was written, there was no such thing as Chabad. I mean, Chabad stands for Chachma Bina V'Das, which there was such a thing. That's a Kabbalistic term which had been used for centuries before that. But in terms of like a movement or an ideology or a group, there was no such thing as Chabad. There was the Magid, and all his students were basically delivering the Torah of the Magid, which was strongly based on the Baal Shem Tov. I mean, exactly what the Magid did to the Baal Shem Tov's Torah is a whole discussion in itself. It seems that the Magid injected more original Kabbalah into Baal Shem Tov's teachings. But you basically had students of the Magid. And when the Alter Rebbe published the Tanya in 1796, there was no such thing as Chabad. No one said he's Chabad, you're Chabad. Didn't exist. The reason why, and it's not a term which the author ever used in reference to himself or his group. What happened was that the book prompted controversy. Because, I have to understand, these people lived in a different universe to us. We have access to every single safe that exists. Look over there, hundreds of beautiful svarim. Our challenge is to get up, pick up the safer, and learn. That's our biggest challenge in life. Not that that things are not available. You go online, you can download 50,000 books for free. I have a hard drive, has 80,000 books on it. I remember once I was sitting in the doctor's office in Flatbush, this is the first time they made an app, and they put the whole Rambam and Shulchan Aruch on your phone. And I'm sitting, and I have that. This is 5-10 years ago, it was a Kiddush. I showed it, look, I have the whole Rambam on my phone. So the guy starts laughing, he says, well, Mazel Tov, your phone knows the whole Rambam. Now you have to learn the whole Rambam. So our challenge is not the availability of information. It's our willingness and our time and our effort to study it. But in 200-300 years ago, major political issues in the Jewish community was how much should be revealed, how what ideas should be made available to the public, what shouldn't be made available to the public. I'm not saying this is a non-issue nowadays. You go to your Rav, you go to your mentor, he'll tell you, I think it's appropriate for you to learn that sefer, maybe it's not appropriate for you to learn that sefer. I'm not saying there shouldn't be any discernment whatsoever. But generally speaking, we don't have, in the realm of traditional Orthodox thought, you go to a store and buy a sefer, no one's going to ask you any questions if you learn it. But then it was an issue, and therefore you also have to realize then the power of the book. You're talking about there was no communication networks that we have today. Information networks were a fraction of a percent of what we have today. Information didn't flow. When you published the book, it was a major disclosure of information. And so the Tanya prompted a quite significant controversy in the Hasidic world itself. Has the author revealed too much? Or you could spin it another way. Has the author rendered the rabbi useless? It's not the first book I wrote. I wrote I discussed writing a commentary called the Good Chumash, which it's based on Lubavitch Rebbe's Rashi talks. He gave over 800 lectures on Rashi, and I adapted a lot of these into a book. And when I first started selling this book, I got the shock of my life. I kept hearing the same complaint that I wasn't expecting. People were coming up to me and says, well, I would buy this for my shul, but I don't want everyone to have this information. I want to have the information. what am I going to say if everyone's got the information? So it is still, I heard this hundreds of times, actually. So the Tanya prompted that level of controversy. You're giving everyone this, so we don't really need the Hasidic Rebbe anymore. It's kind of a Rebbe in a book. It's a mentor in a book. So it was controversial for that reason, and for a number of other reasons. And that's why there was a kind of split in the Hasidic movement, and people who favored this additional disclosure were kind of labeled Chabad. But I don't think, I wrote about this introduction, there's different ways of spinning it. I don't think that the author was trying to make his own path, and I think he was simply trying to give over the teachings of the Maggid. Some research has been done recently into sourcing everything in the Maggid, and you'll see really everything's built on something before. And historically, obviously the Chabad movement takes pride and joy because Rabbi Shmuel Zalman is like the chain of Chabad Rebbe. But, especially in Europe, before the war, everyone's learning Tanya. It was like, because there are very few books that actually do this, that teach you how to serve a Kodesh Baruch Hu practically with ideas or suggestions. And that's because, if you read the introduction, which we won't do today, because I want to get straight to the meat of the text, one thing he interestingly writes is that this is advice he's been giving people for over 20 years when he was meeting them. And that's also a secret of the Tanya's success. Now, if you write a book, you have an idea, you write it down. Every author gets a surprise when his or her book is not a New York Times bestseller. I just can't believe that my book wasn't a New York Times bestseller. Because it's genius. And it took me so long to write it, and why have three people bought it? I just can't understand. Every author has that problem. Because when something ferments in your own mind, you don't realize that other people won't necessarily relate to it. You relate to it, but it's very much your thing. And most Svarim, I'll just give you a very brief taste of introduction, the author writes that most Sifri Machshava, Sifri Musa suffer to some extent from this problem, that the author's coming from their own world. And therefore, he basically says, it's impossible to write a real sefer of Machshava and Musa, but you can't do it. So he says, well, how comes I'm writing this book? He says, well, this is just what I've been telling you for 20 years when I met you, so I'm not really writing a book, I'm just collecting the advice that I gave you guys when I met you, so that when you go home, you don't forget. Which kind of begs the question, you know, he gives these whole proofs, well, it's impossible to write a Sefer Musa, and then he does it, and it's quite a successful one. So, the way I look at it is that he tested this with real people. This was real advice he was giving to real people about their real problems. And when doing this for year in, year out, you hone the system. Like, if you buy a diet book, you want to buy a diet book from the doctor that ran a clinic for 20 years, from people that actually lost weight. You want to just buy, you know, someone's ideas. This book came out of a clinic of a Veda Sashan, of someone who was meeting people again and again. Now, obviously, the Jews of Belarus in 200 years ago had a different set of problems that we do today. So it's surprising that the book is relevant at all, but, you know... when you'll learn it, you'll see it. A lot of it rings home because he really cut to the core of basic issues and what it means to worship Kodesh Baruch. Okay?
Was this the first book that he wrote, or there was others for him before?
He wrote also Halacha.
What book?
He wrote the Shulchan Aruch Harav, which was actually was published posthumously, but before that, he published Hilchos Talmud Torah in his lifetime. Yeah, he was writing.
And the people that came to seek advice. They were Hasidim, or they?
Well, they were people who were interested.
People who were interested.
Yeah, it wasn't, you know, the movement didn't have such really any shape or form at that point.
So for that 20 years, it was all different type of Yidola.
There were people who were learning Shas and Poskim, and they were davening, but they wanted to, you see, he never writes down the questions they ask, but basically, when you read the book, you realize the question they're asking is like this. I'm keeping halacha. I'm davening three times a day. I put on tefillin. I've been learning. I've been doing this for years. But I'm just not feeling enough. It's not engaging my heart enough. When I try to have kavana, it's not, I don't know, my mind wanders. I'm davening. I'm thinking about other things. That was the problem. And so you see, the problems to some extent haven't changed. So the question is, how can we up the spiritual connection of what we're doing to increase kavana, to increase enthusiasm without compromising halacha, observance, traditional observance? How can we do that? That was really what he was trying to address. Now, before we start, since it's Lag BaOmer, I want to read to you a little bit of the Zohar, which is if you turn to the back sheet. The brilliance of this you will only see as time goes on, but I'll try and point it out to you. I want to show you this Zohar, besides the fact it's Lag BaOmer, just so you're going to see how these ideas crop up again and again and again. The same ideas, the same themes. What the Rashbi says here in the Zohar comes up again in the Arizal. Comes up again, all the Sifrei Kabbalah, comes up again in all the Sifrei Musa. It's the same theme again and again and again. And you can say the Tanya is a very big Chiddush, and you could speak about that for hours, or you could say the Tanya is virtually no Chiddush. And he's really just taking the ideas that were there in the Svarim and making them available and practical and useful. You could say that. You could argue that very well. And so, in fact, the title of the book, he didn't call it Tanya. It just became called Tanya. It's the first word of the book. He called it Lukutei Amorim. Lukutei Amorim means a collection of existing teachings. So, he kind of presented it like that. I'm not here to tell you a tradition. I'm here just to collect what Yiddishkeit has to say about worshipping Hashem and just making it accessible to you. Now, of course, you know, there's a whole other school that says, no, that he was an honor, and it's full of chidushim, and Dafke he called it Lukutei Amorim because he wanted to hide the chidushim. You know, there's different ways of, as you can imagine, of looking at this. But one thing I did in the book is whenever he draws from Isaiah or Gemara, anything, I always put the source. And some things are not, you know, it takes a while to find the sources, and I draw on them, you know, others have done a lot of work on this, but it struck me that this few lines of Zohar here really is a whole painting. And the remarkable similarities to many of the themes of the Tanya. So let's just take a look at it while it's still like Boyman, maybe. This is an Akdamas Hazayah, Daf Yudalid Amud Beis, I think, around there. And Rabbi Shimon's just come out of the cave, and he starts darshaning the beginning of Bereishis. As you know, the Torah, the halachas of the Torah, the mitzvahs start with Achayus Azelachem, which Rashi's kasha at the beginning of Chumash. Why do we need all these stories? So Rabbi Shimon kind of rereads the story of Bereishis, and he reads mitzvahs into it to show how the mitzvahs are there even from the beginning. And the first three mitzvahs he reads is Yiras Hashem, fear of God, or I translate it as reverence in English because it sounds more, we can get to that later, fear or reverence. The second one is love, and the third one is how to say Krishna. Now, the Tanya is actually, when it was originally published, there were two parts to it. Now there's five because more was added later. Two parts of the original Tanya was Likutei HaMoharim, which is a guide really to Ava and Yira, or Yira and Ava. And in the second book, he actually writes at the beginning, this is to explain what it says in the Zohar, that when you say Krishna, and then he quotes what the Lashon that says in the Zohar, that says, he says they're beferish, it's based on that Zohar. But it's quite clear that the first part of Tanya, which is basically a long discussion, how do I have Ava V'Yira, is really based here on one of the Zohar. So I just did the one about Yira here. I didn't want to read the whole Zohar today. Pasach Rabbi Shimon. So Rabbi Shimon begins, B'chudei Raisa, with the mitzvahs of the Torah. V'omar, and he says, B'chudei Raisa Yavukutu Brichu, Yisrael Kulu V'Raisa Be'erich Klal Ksivi. That the mitzvahs which HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave to the Yidden, they're all written in general, in other words, in Bereishis. Bereishis Bara Elokim. Hadehi Pekuda Kadmar. When it says Bereishis Bara Elokim, that's the first mitzvah. The Koila Ikri Pekuda Da. Pekuda Kadmar the Koila. It's the first mitzvah of everything. The Ikri Pekuda Da Yiras Hashem. The Ikri Reishis. And why is it called, this is the mitzvah of Yiras Hashem, which is called Reishis. Bereishis Bara Elokim. How do we know that Reishis is Yira? Diksiv, Reishis Chochma Yiras Hashem. The beginning of Yira, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of Hashem. Yiras Hashem Reishis Daat. Another pasuk in Mishlei says, Yiras Hashem is the beginning of Daat. Begin the Milado Reishis Ikri. Because this word, Reishis, is called, it is called, this thing of year is called Reishis, V'doi Tara La'ala Goy Mehemanusa. And it is the gate to go into faith, while Pekudadoi is Kan Kol Alma. And from this mitzvah, everything, the whole world is sustained. Now, this is the Yesod which runs through the Tanya. Actually, it's only in chapter 41 that he really says this explicitly. Chapter 41 is well known because a lot of people learn it off by heart because it's like a segula for Yerushalayim. And he says here, I'll just read the English. You need to remember always that the beginning of worship, as well as its ongoing foundation and nourishing root, is Yira. Why? Because even though that Yira is just the root of Sumera, And Av is the root of Asei Tov, you're motivated to do the positive out of love, and then he says, not good enough, just have Av, and you always have to have Yira. It's a Yesod in the Derech of Chassidus, and it's right here at the beginning of the Zohar.
So then why is it Bereishis? Then why is it Bereishis according to the Zohar? It should be Reishis. Reishis Yiddish.
Okay. Fair enough. I mean, he didn't explain Bara Elokim either.
No, I was going to ask that.
I guess it's through Yira the world is. He didn't think it's Niskayim Alma. Through Yira, Bereishis, through Yira, the world is Niskayim. Then he gets to what else, another Yesodian talent. Yira is parash l'slas sitra. That Yira can really be divided into three different sides, three different types or approaches. Two of them don't really have a foundation, kodakayores, properly. V'chadikara, the yira, and one is like the ikka, the foundation of yira. Is ba'anash, the doch mekudja brucha beginde, yayichem b'noi, they're people who fear God because they want their children to live, v'lo yimusun, shouldn't die, chas v'shon, v'idochel ma'inche dugufa m'udumamayne, or they're worried about punishment in their body or in their assets. V'aldo dochel leitode, so that's why he's always fearing Hashem. Yishtachach yira de'idach l'kutcha b'ruchu loy shavei yikaren. So basically this yira that he has doesn't really have any foundation because it's all based on something else. He really is concerned about himself, not about God. That is what the Zohar is saying. It sounds harsh, but you're going to see this is a foundation of Pnimiyus HaTorah. Is baranash the dochem l'kutcha b'ruchu begin the dochem ha'enshadahu alma, then the people who they're not scared of punishment in this world, but they're scared of the punishment in the next world. And should get him. Train Elaine Lavikar de Yira. Inun. Vashorsha delay. These two are not the foundation of Yira or its root. Yira di Ikara. What is a Yira that's real, that's a real foundational Yira of Hashem? Lamidchal Barnash Lamalay begin di Ihu Rav Shali Vikara Vashorsha to call Almin. It's to have fear, man should fear his master because he is Rav, he is great, Vashalit, and he is powerful. Ikara Vashash the Kal Almin, he is the root of all worlds. Vachayla Kamei Kalei Chashivin, and everything in his presence is like nothing. Now, these three expressions, well, that immediately, for those of you who know Tanya, that'll ring a bell because he quotes that a lot. Vachayla Kamei Kalei Chashivin. Everything in his friends is like nothing. The Tanya is based on a meditative approach. That you have to spend a bit of time and a bit of effort thinking about a Kodesh Baruch Hu in order to have emotions. And this is also based on a Zohar that's mentioned elsewhere. It says that meditative work is Eim Labonim. It's the mother of children. If you have an emotion, it's because it came from a thought. I remember taking my daughter once, she was a little kid, and she saw this ferocious dog. We parked in some alley somewhere, and there was this ferocious dog, and it starts frothing in the mouth, and I was scared, like it was going to jump over the fence and bite us. My daughter's like, oh, nice doggy. Because she didn't realize the danger of it. So, you know, if you don't know that something's dangerous, you don't fear it. Nowadays, you know, we're obsessed with passive smoking. If someone so much as smokes in the street while we walk past, what are you doing? You trying to kill me or something? We get very upset. But, you know, it used to be 10, 20 years ago, everyone was smoking. No one was scared because you didn't know of the danger. So knowledge leads to emotion. That is a foundation of physiology, really, but the Tanya really wants us to spend time thinking about Kodesh Baruch Hu, and that's how you're going to generate real emotions. And how do you do that? So, and it says in Shulchan Aruch, before you daven, you're supposed to think about Roimim HaSakel, the Shiflas Adam. It's basic Judaism, not enough to read a Tanya to think about a Kodesh Baruch Hu. But he offers a more detailed meditation. In a number of places. And the thing he repeats again and again and again, if those of you have the book in front of you, he first introduces chapter 3. And when you think about the Ibishkan, let's see, what does he say? You got to think. Eichu mimalek al almin, how he fills all worlds. V'seviv kol almin, he surrounds all worlds. V'chula kamek aloi chashiv, and everything in his presence is considered nothing. Okay. Now those terms, filling all worlds and surrounding worlds, are other terms from the Zohar. But if you think about it, read the Zohar again. It's actually right here. He's just touched it up. Deihu rav, he's great. What's that mean? He's beyond. He's soiver. He's beyond the world. He's transcendent. Vasholit. But he's also ruling. He's also controlling. That's mimalikal alman. The ikav vasharshakal alman. He's the root of the worlds. He's mimalikal alman. And then vachulakal and kloshim is the exact quote. So this thing that he says here, page 59 of the Practical Tanya, it's probably another 5 or 10 times in the Tanya. I know, because I kept cutting and pasting the sources every time I quoted it. And there's probably another 10 or 20 times where he addresses those ideas without mentioning it explicitly. It's straight from that Dhamma Sazayah, the way that we're taught to have Yiras Hashem. Okay, let's go to the Tanya now. Oh yeah, I was just going to say one more thing that he mentions here. Doesn't that sound a bit harsh? He says that basically, if you have Yiras Hashem, and it's really because you're worried about punishment. He says that's not really your mission. It has no basis. It's not. You're not fearing God. You're concerned about yourself. Doesn't that sound a bit harsh? I mean, aren't we encouraged to have Sifrei Musa speak about Yiras Ha'inesh, that we should be? What is fear? Fear is you're worried about consequences. What's wrong with that?
I wouldn't consider it genuine.
Hmm?
I wouldn't consider it genuine. I wouldn't consider it something that, again, like you said, it's like something, it's not coming from something that you're making yourself awareness of. I mean, it's not from you yourself. It's because of something else you're scared.
Right. Fine. But my question is, isn't the Zohar being harsh? I mean, everyone, you read all the Svarim, they say, okay, you start, the Rambam says, how do you start off? You start educating, you give kids candies.
Well, you mean,
and you give them rewards. And eventually he says, Oisea, Emes, Mipnesha, Emes. You're going to do the truth because it's true. But that's a very high madrega. He calls it the madrega of, the Rambam calls it the Darga of Avraham Avinu. So basically, the Zohar is saying, unless you're on the Darga of Avraham Avinu, you're fake. That's harsh.
So what
it's
you're
not
trying
fair.
To say, you should start off with that you should love Hashem instead of Yiras Hashem?
Well, in love, he says the same thing, by the way. That if you love Hashem, the Zohar, Rabbi Shimon says the same thing. If you love Hashem because he gives you good stuff, you just, you're not
so
you really
good.
So
it's the
yeah.
same exact thing.
Yeah.
Open.
Right. So isn't that, my question is, isn't he being unfairly harsh?
Or he's being incredibly real.
Well, he's being, yeah.
Incredibly real. That look, our relationships, Hashem wants a mature relationship. If we're just going to be a bunch, we're just going to be essentially mechanistic robots responding to stimuli, that's not a relationship. But it is that he wants us to have a kind of a deeper understanding here. Not that we're just going to get whacked and do the wrong thing, but we're aware of the concept, aware of the world that he's created.
So you don't think he's harsh?
Well, that's
no,
he's not. He's being real. Okay.
Greg, when there's a relationship, wouldn't it be better to do it through love than through fear?
But I'm saying no. Fear it means awareness of consequences. Awareness that. You know, you're in this relationship, and if I have certain actions, there are going to be consequences. Not that I'm being punished, but it's just that it's
the
way
the line of punishment.
I don't think
he wants to bring out punishment. I don't think the Alter Rebbe wants to stress on punishment. Why he picks Yidder, I have to think about. But I don't know if it has to do with punishment.
It's straight in the Zohar. Is the Zohar being harsh?
Fear encompasses love.
Okay.
So, you start with the goal, which is the highest, the goal, and then you work towards that, and then with that, it's all encompassing. Everything falls into.
I don't fear my wife. I love my wife.
No,
I love my children.
No, but
I don't
if
fear.
If fear, as the Rav was mentioning, is probably not the right. But a person has reverence as all. They don't want to do something.
That's different. Now, or is it different?
No, Yira, but they both come from the same root. Yira, to be awareness. Do you fear your wife? Do you fear hurting your wife? Do you fear hurting your relationship with your wife by inadvertent actions or even overt actions? By your own, let me take this away from that. Do people, I just want to give that example. I don't want to make, do we as humans fear hurting those who we love because we're inadvertently, even sometimes inadvertently, because of our own failings, we take actions that hurt someone, that negatively affect the relationship. That's something we're concerned about. Not I'm going to get punished or I'm going to yell at them. I'm going to hurt somebody. Why not?
All right, that's an angle to look at.
Okay, so what we're dealing with here.
Is that the right answer?
Well, no. I was trying to stir a chocolate that didn't get stirred. I gave the wrong spoon, obviously. One of the dark underbelly of any Kavana movement, because this is a Kavana, let's upgrade Kavana, let's upgrade authenticity,
mm-hmm.
let's make it more real. The dark underbelly of any Kavana movement is that we're going to be dismissive of those who don't have Kavana. If we're going to say, oh, Ava, Yira, Kavana, Pnimius, whatever you want to call it, Chassidus, piety, that's it. So how are you going to look at the guy that's just, he's just doing basic Shulchan Aruch without a lot of Kavana? How are you going to look at him? Not in a very strong light. And actually, culturally, this was a problem in the Hasidic movement, that in the early days, Chassidim used to mock non-Chassidim. Boy, did they get it back. how do you, you know, the tensions between the Hasidic movement and the surrounding Misnagdim, as they know, those who opposed the Hasidic movement, were, you know, it takes two to tango. The Chassidim wound people up. Because they were proud that we're the Kavana God, you know, we're really worshipping Hashem. And you see this even in the Zohar. Obviously the Zohar is pure, I'm not attributing the dark underbelly to the Zohar itself. But the Zohar is already being dismissive of Yira that's not quite pure. We want pure.
Is that why Shulam Bar Yochai was told to go back into the kingdom? because of this attitude?
Right. Maybe, yeah. Possibly. But this goes through Zohar, it goes through Kabbalah, and it goes through Tanya Chassidus. It's one strong thread. But how are we going to deal with lack of Kavanah? If Kavanah is so important, and the feeling that you have when you do a mitzvah is really crucial, it's the life of the mitzvah. As he quotes later on from Rishonim, there's a saying that mitzvah b'lei Kavanah k'guf b'lei neshama. You have a mitzvah without any Kavanah, it's like a corpse. It's going to be a problem for you. So therefore, a lot of the Tanya is damage control over this idea. I said before that he was the kind of fusion of the Litvish path, the Chassidish path. The Gemara says, Mitoich Shloi Lishma Bar Lishma. There's no shame in doing Mitzvah Shloi Lishma. You'll come to Lishma. It doesn't have any negative connotation. And he spends a lot of time trying to integrate these two ideas. That on the one hand, we wave the Kavana flag, and yes, Kavana is really important, and that's what connects you to God, and everything else is really not enough. And if you just do it without Avavira, your mitzvah's dead. Some chapters he'll follow that theme. But other chapters, he will be doing a lot of damage control, saying, you know what? Even without Kavana, your mitzvah's amazing, and you know why the halacha says, Mitech l'shalai shma b'lishma. And you know what? Even if you never have Kavana your whole life, your neshama's doing an amazing. He keeps flipping because he's trying to find that middle path. So I'm just saying that in the beginning so you can see, you know, be aware of a lot of these things that we're going through.
So is there an adjustment? I like to hear Shirin for Batil. So one of the things that he said was that it seems like the Rebbe changed the focus, or I don't know if that's the right word, but more Ahava versus Yira. He goes over a Maisa that happened. That there was a person who went to, I guess, for dollars, and he says, Rebbe, you know, how do I feel Hashem? And he says, tell me how to fear Hashem. And he says, what's wrong with loving Hashem? But get there, I'm not doing it. Okay. So I'm not sure, maybe it's a generation or from a generational perspective.
I don't know. We could discuss this, but the chapter which the Rebbe told people to memorize the most is chapter 41, which is basic Yiras Hashem, and I think that that's the foundation of the Tanya. And the Zohar, they're both parallel hymns, that's the foundation.
Well,
I think maybe people who are outside, or they're not religious, or they don't want to, you can't give them a half measure, you've got to turn it down.
When I went into Yechid Yisro on my bar mitzvah, the Rebbe told me to memorize Lamed Beis.
Oh, okay. Yes, that's also another popular one, which is Ahava as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And he told me to focus on Ahava, not Yira.
Okay, so this side is armor.
No, I mean, I have
that's beautiful.
To be by the Rebbe Yechidus five times.
Wow.
Before they went into groups.
Wow.
And every time when I went in, he asked me, you know, how you doing?
Well, it's about, Avenir is a balance, and it's something we struggle with our whole lives. Anyway, let's get to the actual Tanya itself. Let's just try and quickly do this parrot so we can actually cover some ground tonight. And we'll do one long introduction. So I'm going to use my translation in this book. You don't actually have to have it, but if you have it, you could follow in the book. So what chapter one is about is the question of identity. Am I really a good person? Am I a good Jew or am I not a good Jew? Am I holy or am I not holy? And what does it mean to be holy? What is my standard? What is a reasonable goal? And a lot of the way that the author is dealing with people coming to him, you know, I'm trying, davening, learning, it's not really happening. It seems that he was always telling people, you've got to have a reasonable goal. What is a reasonable goal for his crowd, which ends up for anyone who reads the book? You'll see. So Perek Aleph begins. Tanya b'seif Perek Gimel din Nidah. We learnt at the end of chapter 3 of Nidah, the Gemara, Mashbimei say titzadik val tirosh, that before a child is born, the soul is made to swear an oath, be a righteous person, a tzaddik, and do not be a wicked person, a rosh. Even if the whole world tells you you're a tzaddik, you should consider yourself like a rasha.
I had a very hard time with this. I had a very, very hard time with this, because what does that actually do? Because when you come down into this world, by telling your neshama to swear this, how is that going to, in reality, deal with what we have to do down in this world? It just doesn't work.
It doesn't work because you'll forget it?
No, because it's hard to even get to this kind of, to, how can you have the neshama swear to be this certain type of standard when you didn't even start it? You're just coming into the world.
Well, it's just like a pep talk before you go on your mission.
To swear to it?
Well, that's what, yeah.
It's tough.
Okay, I hear you. Basically, what he's saying here is always have a pessimistic view about yourself. Always consider yourself a good Russian. Never look at yourself, oh, I'm holy, I made it, I'm a good Jew. And you're going to see there's a steer here because it says something else in the mission. The Mishnah says, don't consider yourself as a Russian. So what is it supposed to be? Do I look at myself as a Russian or not? And then practically speaking, either way is not going to work. If you're going to look at yourself as a Rasha, you're going to become depressed, downhearted. And you're going to become depressed. You won't be able to worship Hashem with simcha. But on the other hand, if you don't become sad at all from being a Rasha, the perception of being a Russian, there's no remorse, then you're going to be flippant. You could become like, you know, not take things seriously. So, basically, convincingly, I think, he says at the beginning that the self-perception of either as tzaddik or as Russia is not going to work.
It's not going to work.
Neither of them are really... They're too extreme. So now he introduces this intermediate category, which is mentioned in the Gemara, and it's called the Beinoni. Now, how many times is Tzaddik and Rasha mentioned in Gemara and Medrash in Midrash Chazal? Hundreds. You could search now on what, you know, on apps and find out. Several hundred, probably, times. The Tzaddik and Rasha are mentioned, maybe more. Okay, how many times is the Beinoni mentioned? Once or twice. It's not a term that's used very often. As you're going to see, the one time it is mentioned, Tanya says it's not the Pshat anyway. But let's just see what he quotes here. So he brings the Gemara brachas. Ki hinim etzinim be Gemara hechushim. There's five categories. The tzaddik v'toivloi, the tzaddik who has it good, tzaddik. Well, there's two ways you can read v'toivloi. Either good happens to him, or inside he's good. I mean, the literal pshat is good is happening. The tzaddik who prospers, tzaddik who has it good in this world. The tzaddik v'ralei, the tzaddik who has it bad in this world. V'rosha v'toivloi, the rosha who has it good in this world. V'rosha v'ralei, the rosha who has it bad in this world. And u'beinini, and the intermediate, in between, I call him. He's not a tzaddik, he's not a rosha. As we're going to see, he's going to have elements of both. Now the Gemara is going to be talking about you know, this whole discussion of who's having it bad, who's having it good. It's not really talking about identity. It's talking about whether you're going to be suffering, God forbid, for various in this world. But you're going to see the Tanya is now going to try and pluck this out of the discussion of the Gemara and use it as a general universal term. Rishon b'Gemara, what does the Gemara say? Tzadik v'tovloi, tzadik gomor. Tzadik v'tovloi is a tzadik gomor. This is another Gemara. Earlier on in the Masechta Brachos. Tzadik v'tovloi means, why is good happening to him in this world and nothing bad is happening? Because he's a real, he's a pure tzadik. It's only good. Tzadik v'ralei, tzadik she'ein gomor. The reason why there's a tzadik who has it bad, he's suffering in this world, good, bad things happening to good people, is because Hashem is giving him the kapara in this world so he can get Eil Haba. But then he brings the Zoya. The Zoya is going to go deeper into translating the term tzadik and the Rasha. V'ra'i mehem nepash mishpotim per tzadik v'ralei. In the Zohar Mehemna, Parsha Mishpatim, it says, Tzadik v'ra'lei. This is the other title I mentioned before. Not that bad happens to him. He contains bad. There's ra in him. Shahara shebei kofef l'tov. But he's still a tzaddik. A tzaddik with bad. Okay, he's got the bad in him. He's kind of overwhelmed or suppressed by the good.
Over completely.
Turn the
wrong
over. Yeah. Now, what's a Beinoni then?
Yeah.
Beinoni's like, who is this guy? So he's going to try and define it now, based on another Gemara. Gemara say, Perek Testa Brachis, Tzadikim Yetzatoy Shoftun. With a Tzadik, it's the Yetzatoy. Is their judge. In other words, it's the internal judge of what to do and what not to do. The inner voice, the tzaddik listens to the Yetzer Tov. Rashayim, Yetzer Hara Shoftim. Rashayim, the Yetzer Hara is their internal judge of what to do. Beinonim, Zevezesh Shoftim. But in the Beinonim, you have both. Yetzer Tov and Yetzer Hara is telling you what to do. So again, it's all these mamarachas are very unclear what it actually means. It sounds like everyone at least has your Yetzer Hara telling you what to do at some point. So the next little piece of Gemara kind of gives the game away, at least to the Baal Tanya. Amar Rabba, Hagoyin on a Beinoni. Rabba said, I'm a Beinoni. So Amalei Abayin. Abayin says back to him, Leishvik Mar. You know, master, you're not allowing anyone to live. If you're the biggest tzaddik around here, and you're just a beinoni, then we're all rishayim. So that's not good for us. So what does all this mean? Lahavin kol zebahit. We need to explain all of this. And as you're going to see, these questions are going to be they're not answered straight away. Some of them answered now, some of them answered later. Kind of leaving, hanging in the air, the question of identity. One more question, then he gets to actually define the Beinoni. V'gam lahavi masha amar Iyiv. Another question is what Iyiv says. Bava Basra, Perek Aleph. Master the universe, you have made it tzaddikim, or you have made it shining. So the obvious question is, Vatzadik v'roshim loy ka'ama. Gemara Nidid, it says that when each child is going to go down and they're going to say what's going to happen to this child in the world, there's one thing we don't say, whether the child is a tzaddik or a rasha. Because we all have free choice, we have bechira, and it's up to you to decide whether you're a tzaddik or a rasha.
Everything else. According to the way he starts off,
huh?
There's no free choice according to the way he starts off, because he's sworn.
Yeah, but you're presuming that he's
going to
follow the oath. It's just...
okay. That's it's something to get into, free choice.
So, what does it mean you've created a shine, you've created tzaddikim? It doesn't seem to make any sense. Now, all these questions, I don't want to dwell on too long because they come back much later. And I've been to Tanya classes where they spend like 5 weeks going through all the questions, and then the guys never turn up for the answers.
Don't tell me, I know. How many times I fought with Rav Yo.
Okay. So, just keep them in the back of your mind. We have these Makairis, they're unclear exactly what it means. Now he's going to try and define what he calls the Beinim. And again, very, very smart about that, what the Baal Tanya did. You want to write, he kind of dug up this term, which everyone's kind of heard of, because it's mentioned in the Gemara once or twice, but no one really knows what it's not in use. And he makes this into the centerpiece of the book. And he's going to say later on, this is the kind of, this is your, if you're reading this book, this is your reasonable goal. The Beinim is going to be the person that we can try and become. The Tzaddik is going to be the person that is beyond our reach. And so it allows him to be Mechadish, but still say something that's based on the Gemara. Gam lahavin mahus madreges Beinim. What is really the Beinim inside? Mm-hmm. Now the only time it mentions Beinim in the Rambam, for example, it's talking about half Averis, half mitzvahs. And he's going to say now, basically that's true if you're talking about schar v'onesh and you're measuring the various mitzvahs, but if you want mahus madreges of beinim, what the term really means, that's not what it means. It can't mean, because practically, I mean, if you're writing a sefer of musar and hadrach and machshava, it's a useless term. No one's half. There's no person in the world who's exactly. I mean, Eibishter knows, but I mean, it's not something you could say. Sure, okay, he's half mitzvah. It's a very fine point. So it's a kind of useless term. So when the Gemara says this, the Rambam says this, he's using it from a Kadosh Baruch Hu's point of view. There's a good guy on this side, there's guys on this side, and there's in the middle. But for us, it's not a useful term. Why not? Why is it not useful like that? If a Beinoni is half Averis, half mitzvahs, Rabba would not be able to get away with saying this, but it's not plausible. If the Rav comes in and says, I can't concentrate during davening. Okay, maybe he's just being honest. If Rav comes in and says, you know, I don't know Shas very well, okay, maybe he's being honest. If he comes in and says, listen, Tuesday and Thursday I eat McDonald's. You say, get out of here, that's not another, you're just messing. Half Averis, half mitzvahs, it's not plausible the Rambam would have been like that. So he had to, another has to be, you know, something realistic. And he brings a vine, a little noida, the way Pasuk Puma Megirsa. It says in the Gemara Baal Metzian, he didn't stop learning. Even the Malach Amavis wanted to take him away. He couldn't because he was learning the whole time. There's no way he could have made that mistake to think he did Averis half the time or anyone else would have believed it. Now, here he brings an interesting thing. And the marker for it is a lishin, the Arzeruah. He says, "V'oi shahai b'shar she'ase avaynis nikra rosh hagana." The moment a person is doing a veda, he's called a rosh. V'imach hakachas a tshuva nikra tzadik. If you do it afterwards, he does tshuva. He's called a tzadik. So when are you going to be a veda? It seems to be like a meaningless term. Half a veda is half mitzvahs. Who's that? And we've rejected that, but even after rejecting it, what does it mean? It doesn't seem to mean anything. Even if a person's Eva Issa de Rabbanan, he's called a Rosh, because it is a Perek Bar based in Rabbis, Perek Kamed in Nidda. It's mentioned in Gemara. And even someone who had the opportunity to be Meicha and stop someone else to Aveda, and he didn't stop us and the other guy doing Aveda, he's also called a Rasha, as the Gemara says in Shavuos. So, what is it then? So he has one more, two more eyes. All these people doing any Aveda is a Rashaim. V'kol shekein v'kol v'chem v'vat leiz mitzvah asi she'esh l'kaimo. So if this person's called a rasha for any deraisa, any derabonin, all the more so if he didn't do a mitzvah asi, he's also a rasha. For example, k'may kol she'esh l'lasik b'teira v'ein esik. For example, he could have learned, he had the opportunity to learn, and he didn't learn. Shalav dasha b'seni z'rchein l'vracha ki davar shen boza k'ayis t'k'ayis, that he's express contempt for the word of God, his soul is going to be cut off. Pshita de mikre yashat feima ev misra rabban. Obviously, this isra of bithel teira is going to render someone a rasha more than being over an isra de rabban. So basically, here is the summary. V'im kein, al kochach habeinani ein bei afilu avon bithel. You have to say that the Beinani did not do any Aveira, and he didn't do the Aveira of Bittul Teira, which doesn't help us much.
It makes it worse.
Because this Beinani has now become virtually impossible, it seems. He's just another type of tzaddik, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And that also means that everyone else is a Rasha, so that sounds really bad. But it does explain the Gemara. If a Beinani is virtually indistinguishable from a Tzaddik, neither of them are doing a Veda, so we can understand why Rabba could have made that mistake and said that out of humility at least. But we're still struggling to understand what the Beinani is. I don't know how much time we have here. I want to leave at some point, I presume. let's at least do a...
We can do a preview for sure.
Do a few more lines. Let's just do a few more lines when he comes to a conclusion on this topic. Otherwise, it's going to take like half an hour to get back into next time. So let's see. So Benini, he's basically saying, doesn't do any of it. He seems to be some type of tzaddik. This is not getting us anywhere, but eventually it will. You've got to bear with it. It seems to be going somewhere that doesn't help us, but it will help us soon, you'll see. But first of all, he has to get rid of this idea that it's half of various half mitzvahs. And it says in the Gemara Shoshana, and the Rambam brings this, that a Beinani is half mitzvahs and half aveiros. So still to everything we just said. So he says very simply, Hushem Hamushal Le'inyas Chavayish. That Gemara is talking about, is using it as a Shema Mushal, which means a borrowed term, a figurative, imprecise use of the term. That Gemara doesn't mean the guy's literally a Beinani if he's doing an Aveira half the week. It means that we're talking about Tzchav Einish and we have to sort out the good guys from the bad guys. We're saying Beinani in Slish. But that cannot be the Beinani, which is, of course, before you read the Tanya, that's what you think the Beinani. If you heard of a Beinani, that's what you think it is. He says, no, that's not the Pshat. Why does the Gemara say that? Lefisha nidan acharupa, because of it. The Rambam says in Hilchos Truma that we're judged according to the roiv. Mikre tzadik bedinei ma'achash ezeich bedin. Person's got a tzadik in din, in judgment, because he survived the judgment and came out positively. Avalein and the mitzvah shematei and ma'ala shel ma'as b'dei tzchulach tzadikim beinim. But if you want what it really means, is Reb Yankel a beinim? Is he a tzadik? The real meaning? You have to go back to the Gemara in Brachas 61b, that's going to be the foundation for his pshat, which says that the tzaddikim are judged by the Yetzer Tov. It means you're a Yetzer Tov guy. That's what it's out. The Yetzer Tov has somehow become you. And how do we know that? Shenemar, as David HaMelech says, the libi chol b'kirbi. David HaMelech said, my heart is empty. And he teaches. It's based on the Yerushalmi. She'ein lo yetzahara. What does it mean, my heart? It means his yetzahara. His desire for negative things. She'ein lo yetzahara. David HaMelech had no yetzahara. So he said, hold on. I read tonight. He had a yetzahara. Well, you tell me he had no Yetzirah. So he answers, Ki Horeg B'Tainis. That's what the Korban Ha'ida says in Yishalmi. He started off with a Yetzirah. And then, Tainesu, you fast enough. It goes away. You drain yourself. Interestingly, the Zaya Chodosh has a different pshat. It says he killed it through Torah study, through learning, basmada, he killed the Yetzirah. Whatever the pshat is, a tzaddik, the Yetzirah is out of the picture. I will call me Shaloi Higil Madregazu, anyone who hasn't reached this level, Afsh Zuchu Yesav Murimel Aveinesav, even though his merits are more than his Aveiris, Ein Ebemanes Madregaz Tzaddik Klal. He is not a tzaddik at all, and he's not even a Bainim. That's why the Chazal said in the Medrash, what's really Gemara Yuma? Ra Kodesh Baruch Hu b'tzadikim shahimu otim. The Kodesh Baruch Hu saw the very few tzadikim. Amad u'shosalon b'chol dar v'dar. He stood and he placed them carefully in each generation. It's not a lot of tzadikim. Because to be a tzadik, you have to eliminate the Yitzhar. Very few people are going to do. Kamasha Kosa, but Tzadik is Saitiwa. Also, the Pasuk says, initially, Tzadik is the foundation of the world. Not many people like that. So, what is this whole decision? You can get lost here very easy. What is he getting to? What he wants to do is get to a situation where everyone reading this book will relate to him. And that happens at the point where there's a schism between the good part of you and the not so good part. We're all in that conflict. And the tzaddik really is not helpful to us, because at least from what it seems from these quotes from Chazal, the tzaddik's past that conflict. He heard about times. Maybe he's in a different conflict. Not saying that his life is devoid of issues, but it's not the conflict with him. The Rasha, on the other hand, seems to be, before you read the Tanya, seems to be derogatory. The way he's translating it here, it seems that most people would fall into this category. I mean, the joke they say about this is, I mean, not really a joke, it's a kind of sociological spin on the Tanya, is that the Rabbi Shneur Zalman, he's learning this with the Maggid, and he's going back to Vitebsk. Vitebsk like Borough Park. Everyone thinks they're a target. So the first thing is to tell them, you know what? How am I Beinoni? You know, you're not even a Beinoni yet. Never mind a tzaddik. There's a certain level of... there's a musa in the beginning of the time. It's basically saying, you did an Aveira once, you're a Rasha. That's a name that comes with any Aveira. And therefore, we have to be aiming for something called Benigni. Now it's going to unfold that what the Benigni really is self. Benigni is what we would really call the Frumiyin, which basically means you have self-mastery, you're controlling yourself, you're keeping a lot of it. Inside, you could have, who knows what's going on inside. You could be in a conflict, you could be desiring all sorts of inappropriate things. But at least in behavior, and in speech, you don't speak lashon hara, you behave yourself. That's what we really need to be aspiring to. And that's how he's going to develop the Bein as the master of the outside. That doesn't mean we should neglect the inside, but it's something, at least the outside is something we can, his theme going to be later on, is this is something we can all do. The Beinim is going to be, this is a book, it's called Sefer Shel Beinim. It's going to be, never give up on external mastery, on Shulchan Aruch, on basic halacha. This is something that everyone can do. And in a sense, this is his solution to how to merge the mystical path, the Baal Shem Tov's dancing in the forest. He's doing all these crazy things in South Poland, and he's trying to bring this back to Vitebsk, to Boropark, to places of learning. So he begins the Tanya and says, listen, first of all you have to know is we're not against Torah, we're not against Halacha L'maaseh. Everyone has to keep the whole Shulchan Aruch. And if you don't keep, if you break one Halacha and Shulchan Aruch, you are a Rashi. And you have to do teshuva. And that is a serious thing, and you're not even a Beinoni yet. So there's a certain... He begins the Tanya by kind of addressing the elephant in the room. This is my own... You don't have to accept. It's all my own musings. And he begins by addressing the elephant in the room. This doesn't sound like Chassidus. I thought Chassidus was this feel-good stuff about how everyone's good, and we let the Perek Lamed Beis... we love everyone, and even if you know, let's have a hug, let's have a kumzitz. This doesn't sound like Chassidus.
See, there's something even deeper. He's grabbing control of language. He's taking a term that has a great makor, but is really not defined, and he's grabbing it and defining it, and now he has owned that term, and that term applies to him. It's actually a rather brilliant move because it's a term of. No one can fault him. There's a great report for it, but he's defined it, and he owns it, and now he owns it in a way that's very helpful. People say this is a concept that we're going to begin with because you've never heard this concept before because this is an undefined term.
Right.
I just think it's a
You're 100% correct.
That's exactly what he's trying to do.
Yeah. That it's a masterful kind of pedagogic move of. Taking the readers on the ground they're familiar with, they've heard this Gemara, but no one really knows Pshat, no one really knows what it means. I'm going to tell you what it means. This is going to be where you're aiming for, and this is going to be why you're not depressed, because it's going to be something reasonable, it's something you can do. So I think we should stop here, and next week, God willing, we'll continue. He's going to start now the doctrine of two souls, and the way we're going to explain the inner struggle is based on what Rabbi Chaim Vital says, that there's a nefesh of Bahamis, there's an animal soul, and really it's brought in the Kabbalah, so it's based on a Ramban, that we also have a divine soul, which Hashem blew into us, and the conflict between these two souls is going to be our conflict. So, but just to kind of sum up, what he's basically, the take-home message is that you will always struggle. The tzaddik hara b'tayni, tzaddik who's killed his yetzahara through tainis, that madrega there's no struggle, at least the struggle as we relate to it. Might be some other struggle. But not struggle inside. You will always struggle. The question is, are you going to struggle on the outside as well? And stumble occasionally and be a Russian and do tshuva and fix yourself up? Or could you aim for someone where the struggle is only on the inside? The Beinoni is going to be the person where he's a kind of tzaddik. I mean, we would call the Beinoni. If we saw a guy as a Beinoni, we would call him a tzaddik. Nah, I'm saying that that's from Jews. People less than a Beinoni, we call him a tzaddik. But basically it means that a tzaddik who's really still struggling on the inside, someone who's got that outer perfection, but there's going to be an imperfection. But his message is, your struggle's real, you're here to struggle, and I'm going to guide you in the struggle. I'm not going to try and say, oh, just be holy. This is going to be a lifelong struggle, and I'm going to give you the tools to do it.
What page did you finish with when we start next week?
Page in this?
Yeah.
Page 36 in the Practice of Italian.
I'm much further into it. I'm only at page 260, but I want to go back.
Oh, okay.